Not a one of the buzziest stories of the week, which raises serious questions for those of us who cover politics. We all witnessed the debacle at NBC this week when they fired former RNC chair Ronna McDaniel just days after hiring her as an on-air contributor after some of the network's biggest names went public to complain.
There's a reason why there's a lot of journalists at NBC News uncomfortable with this, because many of our professional dealings with the RNC over the last 6 years have been met with gaslighting.
We've also said election deniers, is not just they can do that on our airwaves, but that they can do that as one of us, as badge-carrying employees of NBC News, as paid contributors to our sacred airwaves.
The fact that Ms. McDaniel is on the payroll at NBC News, to me, that is inexplicable.
Their biggest issue, Ronna's support for Donald Trump's effort to overturn the 2020 election, something I asked her about last year on my Mac show, Who's Talking? Are you saying, as the chair of the Republican Party, that you still have questions as to whether or not Joe Biden was duly elected president?
Joe Biden's the president.
No, I didn't ask you whether he's the president.
No, I don't think that. I think
Do you
there
think
were lots
he, won,
of
he won the election?
I think there were lots of problems with 2020.
Do you think
he won the election.
Pardon?
But ultimately, he won the election, but there were lots of problems with the 2020 election. 100%.
And that's fair.
But I don't think he won it fair. I don't. I'm not going to say that.
We'll get to the bigger issue of how we should cover Trump in a minute. But first, Eliana, was NBC right to hire Ronna? Was NBC right to fire Ronna?
Look, I probably wouldn't have hired her and probably wouldn't have fired her in that I think there are better spokeswomen for the conservative cause. However, the fact that the Overton window at NBC can't accommodate Ronna Romney McDaniel, but can accommodate folks like Al Sharpton, who falsely accused a man of rape and led a pogrom in Crown Heights, and Joy Reid, who, you know, lied about her bigoted blog post back in the day, I think that's what grinds the gears of conservatives.
Lulu, where are you on Ronna Gate?
Ronna Gate. I think she shouldn't have been hired. I think she's damaged goods, certainly for Democrats, because of what she did in the 2020 election. But also, she wasn't a good representative for Trump either. He basically engineered her ouster from the RNC. And so I wasn't sure exactly what she was doing on the airwaves, who she was supposed to be representing, what kind of perspective
but
she was supposed to be
pressure,
given.
Were they right to fire her?
I mean, you know, at the end of the day, they got to pay her out. I think this entire spectacle that we've seen with all these people on air talking about her and what she's done does no service to journalism and no service to NBC and MSNBC.
This gets to the central question I want to talk about here. Donald Trump almost certainly will be the Republican nominee for president, but he also tried to interfere with the peaceful transfer of power, which raises the question, Jonah, how should the media cover Trump? Do we reflexively correct every misstatement he makes every time he says that he won the 2020 election? Do we have to say, no, he didn't?
It would be nice. Look, I mean, I think part of the problem is we're in a messy place where in the alternative universe where I would prefer to live, it would just be recognized that Donald Trump was unfit to run again because of what he did on January 6th, and Ronna McDaniel would be unfit to be part of public discourse because of her aiding and abetting of it. We don't live in that world. What happened on January 6th now is just simply another one of the partisan contentious issues. And so that makes it really hard to cover. I think that the real problem isn't that the mainstream media isn't welcoming of principled conservatives who are willing to articulate conservative positions. I would say Eliana and I are two of them. The problem is that in terms of partisan politics, liberal versus conservative on issues doesn't really matter very much anymore. The defining issue is whether or not you're sufficiently loyal to Donald Trump as a Republican. And that is what this election is basically going to be about, is Joe Biden is going to be running again as not Donald Trump. And it's going to be a referendum about whether people want Donald Trump back in their lives for another 4 years. And finding people who can hold a consistent line and make an intelligent, consistent argument in defense of Donald Trump is difficult when Donald Trump continually changes what his points of views are and says things that are often indefensible.
He floods the zone. That's what he does. It's, you know, you can listen to Steve Bannon for 5 seconds and he talks about it. He floods the zone with lies, and then you don't know which one to grab at any one time. And it's part of a project. It's not, it's intended. He likes to pretend it's just crazy making, but it isn't. It's actually
part of it. The question I have is, how do we cover him? I mean, do we kind of, every time that he says something,
that's not true. You have to you're a reporter, right? And you have to, like you were just pushing back with Ronna McDaniel. Now, eventually, they tire you out. They try to tire you out, but you have to say every single time, that's wrong.
I disagree. I disagree.
Politicians lie a lot.
I disagree for this reason. I think you have to cover Trump dispassionately. I think what we've seen here is that everyone gets so, you know, enraged. There is so much discourse around this. There is so much heated rhetoric that it just actually, what you see, and we've seen this, is that people just tune it out. And so if you're constantly putting Kyra...
That's actually the question I have, does it become noise at some point?
It just becomes noise at some point. And so I think you have to pick and choose your battles.
But that is the strategy to make it noise. This is what they do
online. I'm not saying January 6th is noise, but I am saying that Trump and right now what's happening with his legal cases might be noise.
All right, go ahead.
The bloodbath line overreaction served Trump's purposes. I'm not saying Trump should...
Let's talk about what he said. Was he was talking about...
He's talking about the auto industry, and he said, if I'm not elected, there'll be a bloodbath, and that'll be the least of it. And so people immediately said, oh, he's talking about violence. And look, he has no credibility to say he wasn't talking about violence, but at the same time, it's pretty obvious that the media got itself really worked up on this, and a lot of normal Americans looked at it and said, eh, I don't think that's what he was doing. Sometimes you have to let some of these things go and pick your targets.
And then I want to bring one last thing into this discussion, because you can't ignore it. This happened this week. Donald Trump selling Bibles for $59.99.
All Americans need a Bible in their home, and I have many. It's my favorite book. It's a lot of people's favorite book. This Bible is a reminder that the biggest thing we have to bring back America and to make America great again is our religion. Religion is so important. It's so missing.
Kara, he's selling Bibles. Sure. He's selling gold sneakers. Mm-hmm. And he's selling Victory 47, because if he's reelected, he'll be the 47th president. Cologne and perfume.
Yes.
The floor is yours.
He is our
Home
Shopping Network president. This is great. You know, my favorite part was the person that was, when he was trying to sell the Bibles, they asked him his favorite verse, and he still can't come up with them. It's just, it's comical, but, you know, Bible's a good book, I guess.
Show me the money.
Show me the money.
He's the show me the money president.
Yeah, absolutely.